Listen to part of a lecture in a geoscience science class. Okay, any more questions about plate tectonics?
Yeah, I noticed that. Our textbook readings seem to imply that plate tectonics played a big part in the evolution of some of the earliest complex life forms.
They only implied this because the connection between plate tectonics and early evolution isn't very well understood yet. But there are a lot of hypotheses, and a couple of new ones are very interesting.
Is there any time to talk about them today?
Sure, I can do that now, but we need to begin with what's known from the fossil record. The fossil record indicates that there was a huge increase in the kinds of organisms that live in the Earth continents starting around 530 million years ago, when there used to be only simple life forms. Then quickly emerged a wide variety of complex multicellular forms. This time period, 500 to 600 million years ago. It's called the Cambrian period, which is why we call this proliferation of new species, the species diversification, the Cambrian explosion. Now, one pretty intriguing and I think quite logical scenario to explain all this has been proposed by a group of Australian researchers a few years ago. They believe that the Cambrian explosion was probably fueled by a massive influx of nutrients into the ocean. Nutrients, as you know, are substances that organisms must have in order to live, like iron, calcium, potassium, and so on. And this idea makes sense to me, because any time in Earth's history, when there was a rapid increase in new species, it's always associated with an increase in availability of nutrients of food.
So what caused the influx during the Cambrian period? I mean, where did all the nutrients come from?
Well, according to the hypothesis, the source of the nutrients was a gigantic mountain range. The erosion of a gigantic mountain range, I should say. The researchers called this mountain range the Gondwana Supermountain. The Gondwana Supermountain would be in Gondwana, a supercontinent in the southern hemisphere made up of present-day America, Africa, India, Australia, and Antarctica. The Gondwana Supermountain formed during the early Cambrian era. By formed, I mean plate tectonics caused smaller continents to slowly crash into each other to create one giant continent, and stresses of the collisions could form the Gondwana Supermountain.
So is that how the Himalayan got lifted when India crashed into the Asia?
Southern Asia, right. And that's the beauty of this hypothesis. It is based on currently available geological evidence. So imagine this giant mountain range, 8,000 kilometers long and 1,000 kilometers wide, the largest ever near the equator weathering and eroding. Remember that weathering refers to the breakdown of rock into soil, primarily by physical and chemical forces that occurs most quickly in the tropics, where the heavy tropical rainfalls would carry countless tons of the weathered supermountain and all that nutrient-rich soil within it downhill into the ocean.
So how about those nutrients get into the food chain and affect species diversification?
That would have been first absorbed by simple marine plants like algae, then by the microorganisms that ate the algae, and then by the larger organisms that ate the microorganisms, and up on the line. At each level, populations were quickly expanded, diversified, and in just 5 to 10 million years evolved into increasingly complex species. For example, with infusion of calcium and molecules containing calcium, we get the widespread appearance of the first shell animals and first animals with skeleton to develop in a range of species.
But what evidence do the researchers in Australia have to prove that the Gondwana Supermountain naturally exists?
Well, there are certain sandstone deposits in the southern continents. Remember, sandstones are very common sedimentary rock made up of small particles of rock remnants. The sandstones, as the researchers collected, contain a variety of minerals including zircon.
Zircon? That's not a nutrient, is it?
No, but zircon is important to the hypothesis because it can be dated. The age of zircon samples collected in Australia closely match those in the zircon samples from Africa and India, and from other continents that were once part of the Gondwana. This similarity in age suggested that zircon crystals and sandstone deposits that were found all erode from the same source, the Gondwana Supermountain.